Welcome to another exciting episode of Chemistry 106. I love this close-up photograph of gypsum because you can just see such amazing detail. Like right out in here, you just see all these interesting fissures and cracks and layers and whatever this stuff is right here. Just awesome. I love this to be the first picture in this PowerPoint slide set because we're going to talk about gypsum. Take a look at this picture. In this picture, you can see the molecular model of gypsum, and you see an actual pretty large sample. This is about maybe 7 or 8 inches long, and maybe 3 inches wide. In the picture of the molecular model, you can see how the geometric shape of the molecular model matches that of the gypsum sample. And if we get a close-up view from the side, you see that the same thing is true. Notice how you have this angle right here and this angle right here matching up. And then this top is flat. Really pretty amazing. I wish we were in class so I could show you how they match up and I could pick them up and rotate them and all that. But in actuality, you're kind of getting a better view than the average student in previous years because you can see how these things line up pretty clearly right here. So molecular structure matters, and we see that through the structure of solids. But we haven't talked about solids before. We've only talked about liquids in 106. And in 105, you spent a lot of time talking about gases. So you see through the example of the gypsum that the shape of the molecular model predicted the shape of the macroscopic view of gypsum. And strength is another way that the molecular structure influences the actual material that we're working with. Here's an example of diamond. This structure of diamond, it has a bunch of carbons in a tetrahedral arrangement, but those bonds are covalent, whereas in salt you have a pretty weak solid, right? Salt breaks pretty easy. You don't see people walking around with salt rings on their fingers, right? It's ionic, right? So the molecular structure influences the strength of the material if you just think about the bonding. And last but not least here is the idea of the reactivity. So for example, you have this molecule right here versus this one, which is ionic, right? Sodium nitrite, no big deal. This one right here is very explosive. I actually went to the stock room and asked for, hey, can you get me some trinitrotoluene? And they were like, okay. And they looked it up on the computer and they're like, sorry, we don't carry that. I'm like, that's because it's TNT. That's an explosive. And they're like, you got us. So the reactivity of a substance, of a solid, is influenced by the kinds of bonds that it has. Specifically on this molecule, it's these nitro groups which are making the molecule particularly unstable. Best understanding a solid material would come from understanding the structure of where the atoms are and how they hook up. So if we approximate atoms as spheres, how do spheres pack together? Spheres pack together in different ways. Let's look at a really simple, easy way. There's two and then three dimensions right there. So this is just a really simple way to stick a bunch of spheres together. This is how polonium stacks together, and it's an arrangement called simple cubic. Each of the atoms, their center is at the vertex of a cube. And we call it the unit cell. That cube right there we call the unit cell. Now the cube doesn't really exist. It's a representation that humans put into the situation. It's something that we approximate so that we can understand the patterns of how the atoms are stacking up throughout a particular material. Okay? So think of the eight spheres as where the atoms really are, and the cube as a representation that humans project onto this particular group of eight polonium atoms, for example. Okay, so imagine that the unit cell we were just looking at, let's go to two dimensions for a second, and imagine that this little blue and gray square is that unit cell. How do we actually get a crystal or something macroscopic we can touch? Well, in two dimensions you have the square, but in three dimensions you have these cubes, and throughout a material you have a whole bunch of unit cells right next to each other that are sitting on these lattice points. And there we go. This is what we call the crystal lattice. You have a whole bunch of what would be, in this case, polonium atoms stacked up in this arrangement. So each of the cubes you have here is what we would call a unit cell. And the unit cells form together a crystal lattice with the atoms of polonium at lattice points. Okay, so there's your vocabulary. Unit cell, lattice point, and crystal lattice. So here you go. Here are some examples of iron pyrite, which is a material that follows the simple cubic form. Look at that picture on the right. Look at this. That is amazing. I've never seen an iron pyrite sample that high quality. This is the one that's in my office. Now you can see that there's little tiny cubes there all over the surface, but it's nothing like this really amazing sample. So that's an example of what we see when something is simple cubic. Okay, so on this slide, we're going to talk about the three different kinds of packing patterns for spheres. The first one, simple cubic. And if you take that unit cell, you out of the center of this structure on the left, over here, if you take the center out of this, it would look like this. That would be the unit cell. And it has a length, the unit cell has a length of L, but that represents 2 radii of the individual atoms in the simple cubic. So that's that. So if you're interested in understanding the relationship between the unit cell length to the radius of an atom, then it's pretty easy. 2R equals L. Because what you have in here is you have 8 1/8 of an atom. And so this is one radius, here's another. Now the total number of atoms in this unit cell is 8 times 1/8, because there's 8 vertexes here, okay? Now that represents one atom per unit cell. So there's 8 times 1/8. Okay, you get the point. All right. Another one is the face-centered cubic. Now the face-centered cubic is just slightly different because we've arranged to have another atom that is looking right here at this face. Here's another one on this face right in the middle, and there's one right here in the middle of this face. The face-centered cubic. Now if we were to go through and pull out the unit cell of this one, it would look like this. Now in this one, it's a little different because yeah, we have those corners pulled out, but we also have that face-centered atom right here. And half of that atom is within the unit cell. And so, and there are 6 faces on this cube, right? So 6 half atoms and 8/8 atoms makes a total of 1 + 3 = 4. 4 atoms per unit cell. So what's the relationship between unit cell and radius for a face-centered cubic? Well, it's not exactly the same as the simple cubic because we can't just represent R, the radius of an atom, by just shooting across the front, because we need to go through the face-centered atom, because it goes here to here is an R radius, here to here is a radius, here to here is a radius, and here to here is a radius. So we need to actually go diagonal. Remembering your geometry, if you go across the diagonal of that square, that is from here to here, and using geometry, that is L root 2. So the representation of the relationship, the mathematical relationship, the mathematical relationship is represented by this formula. There are 4 radii that go across this diagonal, and the relationship of the length of the unit cell to that distance is L root 2, which happens to be 4 radii. Well, why are we doing this to you? Well, you're going to have to convert between unit cell length and radius to do some interesting problems. There's one more we need to look at, though, before we can look at interesting problems. Okay, body-centered cubic. This has an atom right in the middle of the body of the unit cell. Okay, if we cut out the unit cell, it looks like this. Okay, here's the length. Where's the radii? Here's one, but there's a gap. Here's another one. How do you figure that out? Well, what we have to do is we have to actually go through the cube. So that would be from this vertex all the way to the back with this vertex. That's how you figure that out. And that is actually, let's see, one radius to get to here, two radii to get through the middle atom, and then another radii. So it's similar to up here where we have four radii equal to that distance, but how do you figure out that distance? Well, it's different than the face-centered cubic because this is now three-dimensional diagonal. And so if we have a three-dimensional diagonal, it actually turns out to be L root 3. So the relationship looks like this. Okay? So there is a mathematical relationship that changes depending on what kind of unit cell you have. What kind of structure do the atoms take in a particular solid? And so we're going to use a different equation based on what kind of solid we're dealing with. Okay, now let's take a look at a problem. I hope there's some Lord of the Rings fans out there. All right, here's an example of the kinds of problems you're going to see. Let's take a look. If the radius of gold atoms in this ring is 144 picometers, what is the edge length of the face-centered cubic unit cell? Okay, let's look at this. What they're giving you is the radius of one gold atom. So imagine a gold atom in this gold ring. The radius is 144 picometers. They're telling you that the gold arranges itself in the face-centered cubic style. And your job is to figure out the edge length of the unit cell. So in order to do this problem, you have to be able to recall the equation for the relationship between the atomic radius and the unit cell. For face-centered cubic, it is this equation. Now, notice that they gave us the radius, so we can plug that in, and we don't have the edge length in this equation, and so we solve for L, and we get 407 picometers. So that's the edge length of the unit cell. And so if you know how many atoms are in the unit cell, then you could say the density of the material and how many atoms there are per certain volume, and there's a bunch of other things we can do. Let's take a look. Ah, see, that's exactly what they want us to do here. Let's calculate the density of gold in the ring. The face-centered cubic unit cell of gold has an edge length of 407 picometers. Yeah, no duh, I just calculated that. I wish you would have told me that like 10 minutes ago. I would have just even skipped that whole problem. No, I wouldn't. Anyway, all right, here we go. Calculate the density in grams per cubic meter. Now, this is actually a multi-step kind of an approach. So let's ask ourselves some questions that will help us put the whole strategy together. First, let's find out how many atoms are even in the unit cell. Then if we could figure out the mass of the atoms, we could start sticking the mass and the volume together for a density. Okay, how many gold atoms per unit cell? In order to know this, you've got to go back two slides where we were showing you that the unit cell for a face-centered cubic looks like this. There were 8 1/8 corners and 6 halves, making 4 gold atoms per unit cell. Okay, well, we could figure out the volume of the unit cell. It's a cube of 407 picometer sides. What's the mass of one unit cell? Well, how much do they weigh? Well, there's 4 atoms, and I know that how many atoms there are in a mole, and I know the amount of grams per mole, and so I can calculate the mass of those 4 atoms. 1.308 times 10 to the negative 21st grams. Okay, so I'm trying to figure out the mass of the unit cell, and now I'm going to figure out the volume of the unit cell. So volume is equal to the length cubed, which is, oh boy, you see what we had to do here? Okay, things just got a little complicated because I have picometers here, okay? And so I've got 407 picometers converted to centimeters because they asked me for centimeters right here. So 407 picometers converted to centimeters gets me this volume. By the way, the place where people are going to mess things up is they're going to put 10 right here. They're going to put 10 times 10 to the negative 10. It's actually 1 times 10 to the negative 10. Okay, anyway. Now we can calculate the mass over volume, take those two values, divide them by each other, and we get 19.4 grams per cubic centimeter. And that's how you calculate the density of a material based on its atomic structure. And if you make a macroscopic measurement of gold, you measure its volume and its mass, and you calculate the density, that's exactly what it is. And that's how we figure this out based on the atomic structure. Hey, an eye clicker question. Okay, it is an eye clicker question, so let's take a look. The density of tantalum is 16.7 grams per cubic centimeter. Estimate the length in picometers of the unit cell. Oh, and they told us it was body-centered cubic. That's helpful, and it's multiple choice. Okay, so we're gonna have to figure this out. The density of tantalum. The density is that. Estimate the length of the unit cell. Okay, well, we know that it's a unit cell, and that unit cell, sorry, what I meant to say there is, we know that it's cubic. And if we know that the unit cell is cubic, we could figure out the volume from the density. If we know the volume, then we could figure out the length of one side, because it's a cube. So, I'll give you that little hint, and you go ahead and pause the video and try it out. Ready? Pause. And 3, 2, 1, click in and stop. All right, let's see what everybody said. Or not, as the case may be. Sorry. Just trying to be silly. Okay, here we go. What is all this here? We've got density equals mass per volume. We already knew that, but we want the volume. Because you can see, if we can get the volume, then we can get the length of one side. Because it's a cube. It's a cube. And the volume of a cube is the length cubed, right? So if we can say that the length is equal to mass over the density, and we can calculate each of those. The density actually was given right here. So let's just figure out the mass. But in order to do that, we need to know how many atoms are in a BCC unit cell. And that was good. 2. Number of atoms and number of atoms cancel. That gets us into moles, moles times moles. They gave us the density, and we solved for L. Okay, so what about this? What we're trying to get you to do is to be able to do the calculations for going between density and unit cell volume and length and all those kinds of things. So that's just an example of a kind of problem that you'll see on your homework. And the answer is right there. Blah, blah, blah. Move on. Okay, these are other types of unit cells that are out there, and there you can see that they're characterized by the way that the geometry is. Here you have A and B the same, but C is not the same, thus you have this rectangular polyhedron here, right? Here's your orthorhombic triclinic rhombohedral. So here, none of the angles or none of the sides were the same. This looks more like the gypsum, doesn't it? So you don't have to have these geometries memorized. We spent all of our time talking about body-centered cubic, face-centered cubic. Now imagine that same kind of thing over here, like body-centered hexagonal or something. But it's, these are just to show you that there are other types. You don't have to have anything memorized from this particular slide. It's just to expose you to the different kinds of things that could be there, could be out there in terms of unit cells. Oh, I love this part. Okay, how is solid structure determined? Well, if we had a crystal that we wanted to know what its solid structure was, we would give it to Dr. Smith, Dr. Stacy Smith in our department. She is our X-ray crystallographer, and we could give her a crystal and she could figure it out. But how does that work? What is it that she's doing? Well, in order to figure that out, we kind of have to talk about the principle or the concept of diffraction. All right, so here is a little animation about diffraction. There's a wave front coming in and it hits these two holes. And these two holes have the wave coming through, and you can see that the two waves are interacting with each other. Do you see that? Now, imagine that at the points right here. See this point right here? Imagine right there, the two waves are combining in constructive interference. The two waves are both up at that time. We would say that they are in phase with each other. They're both up at the same time, creating a wave that is twice as high. In other places, destructive interference is happening. And so you have areas where the wave on the top, let's say, is high and the wave on the left is low when they meet, and those two effects cancel each other out. We say that that's destructive interference. Okay, so that's the idea of diffraction. A really easy way to talk about or to show diffraction is through using a laser. What I'm going to do is I'm going to shine a laser through this projector slide. What I want you to see is that this projector slide has the same pattern as the patterns. Oh, sorry. This projector slide has the same pattern as these dots on the side. Here we go. Watch this. Let's rotate a little bit. Okay. So now you can see that dark, dark, light, dark. See, look, dark, dark, light, dark. And then this is kind of dark, light, light, light. That's exactly what's happening here. So this area is A, this area is B, and so on and so forth. If I shine a laser through only the A region of the slide, it looks like this. Here's B and C and D, and they're all different. Look at that. That's crazy. Depending on the size of the dots in the pattern, you get a different diffraction pattern. So in the previous slide, we were doing one-dimensional diffraction. Here we're doing diffraction in two dimensions. And the kind of pattern we're sending the laser through, it's different. We have a different pattern, and I don't even know what I'm saying. Look at this. This pattern right here looks like kind of like this pattern, but this pattern doesn't look anything like this. Wow. So why did that happen? That happened because the dots of the pattern that are on the slide are microscopic. The distance between the dots is about the size of the wavelength of the light of the laser, and so then you get diffraction. I could have done the exact same thing with a piece of hair. Hair is really tiny, and if you shine a laser, if you block a beam of a laser with a hair, the hair will diffract the laser. It makes little tiny dots to the side because it's starting to approach the size of the wavelength of light. Now imagine, instead of doing this in two dimensions, we did it in three dimensions. Oh, wait. We got to show you the video. This is me with the laser in my office. There's pattern A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and H. So you can see that as I move the slide to allow the laser to pass through a different area, you get completely different patterns. Okay, now let's go to three dimensions. Okay, imagine sending light through something that had three dimensions. Okay, what's the spacing between atoms? It's very tiny in a crystal, right? If we gave a crystal to Dr. Stacy Smith, she would need a crystal that had regular patterns. And if the crystal has regular patterns, X-rays will be diffracted by that regular pattern. The size between atoms is about the wavelength of X-rays. So X-rays are diffracted by crystalline solids, and it makes a pattern like this. Oh my gosh, I think that's so cool. So, okay, imagine that you have this array of atoms and they have some distance between them. Well, what happens is the X-ray instrument actually changes the angle at which the X-rays are hitting the crystalline solid. And you use a special equation to figure out the angle that where things are being reflected and creating these diffraction patterns. And then a computer looks at the patterns. So here's a better example. So a computer then looks at the pattern that comes out from the X-ray diffraction. Let's go back to the top here. So let's say we have some crystal, and here's the crystal, here's its structure. We have an X-ray tube. So I actually went to our lecture prep. We had an old one. So this thing right here is just cork. That's just a piece of cork. We're looking top down on this X-ray tube. So notice how this is angled a little bit right there. See how this is angled right here? I tried to make it so you could see that. You push high voltage through the ends of this thing, and it works like a cathode ray tube. You're ejecting electrons, and they hit this surface right here. And this could be molybdenum or copper or some other material, and then the X-rays would shoot out this way. Then you use a lead screen so you have a nice beam. That beam goes through the crystalline solid, you get your diffraction pattern. But then because the computer knows what angle the pattern was created at, it can deconvolute the data and interpret those patterns and say, oh, guess what? You have a body-centered cubic structure. And the computer then can even take even more complicated structures and determine the relative spatial arrangements of the atoms. Really neat and very powerful technique, especially when you're coming up with when you are trying to come up with a new drug, some new medicine. You have to know what its structure is, and this could be one of the main techniques to figure out the structure. So you can say, hey people, here's this pharmaceutical drug that we're proposing to be used for such and such. Here's how it behaves. Here's its structure. And then people know how to make it. Of course, you're going to get a patent and all this kind of stuff. But anyway, super, super fun. Very, very cool technique. Now, this pattern right here is the X-ray diffraction pattern of DNA. This picture on the left, this is Rosalind Franklin. If you do not know the story of Rosalind Franklin, I highly recommend that you go to Wikipedia and look her up and read her story. She's fascinating. She actually ended up giving her life in her work as an X-ray crystallographer. So, yeah, she's awesome and fascinating. She knew that this little X pattern right here meant that the DNA was helical. She knew that. And that was a key piece of data in the process of figuring out the helical structure of DNA. But that is not the only important thing that she figured out. She also did important work with RNA, figured out the structure of polio. This woman was amazing. She did really cool stuff. So I highly recommend that that you look up her story and get familiar. It's a good one. Okay.